Organic milk is not necessarily organic because there are so many people know now how to get around these regulations in order to produce that and then cash in. And the same problem we're facing now here also in Canada. And that is that people go in, farmers get into that because it looks like as if it's an easy money-making enterprise. People want the milk, people don't ask the right questions, people do not understand, they just hear raw milk, and then farmers get into it and say, oh, well, that is great, I'll just do that, and I'll milk the people, and the people can get my milk. And that is a very, very kind of critical path we on now, because the legal battle is not finished. And if we, in this whole path now we are going, that means when it goes through the ranks, we don't know what the ruling will be on our raw milk case now, on the cow shearing. But if something goes wrong for whatever reason and we cannot prove due diligence, then we derail the entire process of legalization of raw milk. Okay? I understand the desire to be free. I understand the desire that we want to do everything, you know, that everybody wants to do their own thing, and I understand that. And I think everybody should be able to do that. But at the same time, we also need to develop a little bit more responsibility in regards to what the public, how the public sees the entire raw milk issue, because the majority of people think raw milk is a scary proposition, yeah? Especially when you go and hear some of the arguments brought forward. And that is where I feel very strong that we become much more concerned about how the process, how we establish a process, how we recommend farms and how farmers get into it, and how we recommend to other consumers how to get their milk. So, I want to do that with Gary. Gary is a good friend of mine, and he has been with me for a long time. Trial, that's right, at the first trial, 1994. That's right, in 1994. And Gary has, for years and years, almost a lone voice in the wilderness, in the wilderness, talked about the safety of raw milk. But you never hear Gary talking about wash your bottle or, you know, wash the teeth. He always talks about something so profound, and that is raw milk safety starts with soil fertility. So, if now a farmer says, oh, I want to, oh, I'm good, I'm switching to raw milk, and I clean my bottles right, and I do all that, and now you have safe raw milk, it's completely wrong. Because the entire fertility balance and whatever is connected to that affects the guts of the cow, affects the health of the cow, and whatever you get out of the cow will then be accordingly. And that is, Gary, can you just frame that?
I can't do anything briefly.
Well, we force you to. Can you just briefly, basically, go over the basic principles? Gary has put out a raw milk warning, okay? Where he lined out, and I think everybody, before you go, make sure you pick that up, yeah? It gives you a basic outline what he will briefly talk about. Okay, Gary. Gary Wilson, Cowshed member for a long time, and we have done quite a few things together, actually, in regard to research the safety of raw milk and the quality and so on. Okay? Gary.
Obviously, throughout what Michael's been going through since the raid, I've been talking to him as to what was going on. And one of the things I know Michael agrees with is if we win in the court case, which may be probable, we haven't won. Because the problem is, if farmers see the money that Michael charges for raw milk, and the public says, I want raw milk, but they're not informed on how to make choices, how to discriminate in which raw milk they might choose, then they can be sold the milk that is in the stores that is pasteurized from the farm, unpasteurized. And it's not only, in my opinion, not worth drinking from the store, it's not worth drinking raw. And I have over here, since I have no credentials, I have some books that I have read and studied. And I'm sure you've heard of Weston Price. You might have heard of Francis Pottinger Jr., Pottinger's Cats, mm-hmm. Andre Voisin. And if you're familiar with nutrition and physical degeneration, the foreword to the supplement and one chapter in the supplement are not written by Price, or written by William Albrecht. And I have four volumes of his papers. And unfortunately, farmers don't study the work of the soil scientists. But basically, what I find through my investigations is if you look at milk nutrition and milk safety, there's a relationship. So you can do as Michael does and simply argue from the safety of the milk. And when you're producing safe milk that's pathogen free, as a consequence of that, it's also and in order to produce nutritious milk, that's what you have to do. And there's many factors involved, and I probably don't have enough time today, but one of the concerns for me in agriculture, as pointed out by the soil scientist William Albrecht, back in his day in the 30s, 40s, and 50s in the last century, he was continuously pointing out that we are measuring our agriculture products simply by yield or bushels or quarts, and we have no concern with nutritional value. And he was pointing out back then, as these yields per acre were going up and the scientist producing the new crop or the new fertilization method was so happy, the total nutritional value per acre, even though there was more product, was less nutritious. And so if you want to consider it a dilution effect, so what is your average production per lactation down to now?
3,500.
Oh, pretty good. Yeah, it was around, I think it was around 4,200 when I started buying milk. But by getting the production down in association with what else you're doing, you're probably increasing the nutritional value per liter. Not only in the total amount, but some of the things that are going to be in the lower volume milk won't even be there in the larger volume milk, even in trace amounts. So I don't think there's going to be any difference between Michael's milk and the store-bought milk in the calcium content. It's just that the organic molecules that you need to make use of that with your body are not in the pasteurized milk or that milk raw. So some of the concerns that I think if you're going to tell other people about raw milk and guide them, I accept my responsibility to be informed when I talk to other people. So I tell them, you can't go out to a farmer producing milk for the current system and buy his milk raw, because there's too many factors in that not only have removed any nutritional value, but also make it potentially dangerous or even lethal. In a simple example is that it doesn't matter whether your milk is organic or otherwise, cattle are not designed to digest grain. And the major feed that they're given is corn. And if you go to a website from Cornell University regarding E. coli 015787, which you might have heard of, you'll find that one of the professors there explains that when cattle eat the grain, the corn in particular, which is part of the high production diet to get that large quantity of milk, some of this grain makes it through the entire digestive system undigested, where it gets into the colon, where it ferments. That is the terrain, thinking of pasture, that creates acid-resistant E. coli like 015787. The normal E. coli found from a grass-fed cow in the feces are acid-sensitive, which means when you consume it, it's destroyed by your stomach acid. But the acid-resistant varieties, and I think this new one over in Germany sounded to me like, here's another acid-resistant variety produced by grain feeding. That's the one that can go through your entire digestive system. The other thing with respect to when you start to produce quality milk, a good test of that, which I'd be willing to perform with Michael's cows, is to take some of the feces from one of his cows and put it in the milk I drink, strain out the solid matter, and then drink it. And the reason I would do that is because I know there's no pathogens in the feces. So when the government says, no matter how clean you are, you're going to contaminate your milk with the feces, and I say, well, to get the pathogen in the milk, then, does it have to be in the feces? And it isn't. How much more time do I have?